Hello again, everyone. We are happy to host our speaker, Dr. Meltem Elitaş from Sabancı University Mechatronics Engineering Program. So let me say a couple of sentences about Meltem Hoca's achievements. So Meltem Elitaş is a faculty member at Sabancı University Mechatronics Program since 2015. She was a postdoc in bioengineering department at Yale University. She worked with Professor Fan, developed microfluidic artificial tumor in microenvironment assays to study cancer heterogeneity and cancer immune interaction. She received her PhD degree in bioengineering and biotechnology from École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, EPFL, you know, in Switzerland in 2012, where she worked with Professor John McNee and Professor Philip Renaud on understanding mycobacterium persistence at single cell level using microfabricated tools. And Dr. Elitaş received her master's degree in mechatronics engineering from Sabancı University in 2007, where she worked with Professor Shabanovich's research group, and she studied function-based control. And her BS is in electrical engineering from Yıldız Technical University in 2005, and meanwhile she studied mathematical engineering as a double major, and her research interests are phenotypic heterogeneity in cancer and infectious disease, single cell microfluidic technologies, biosensors, cell imaging, and surgical tools. Meltem Hocam, thank you so much for coming, and we are ready to hear you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Sami Hocam. Thanks a lot for these kind words and introduction. And I'm sorry for this communication problem with the Zoom, although we should get used to it through the courses. Today, I will talk about microfabricated tools for quantitative biology. As you heard from Sami Hocam, she said that it was like related to my doctoral studies. At that time, I would like to do some biology work, but then I understand that making tools is also science and really necessary. Through my talk, you will see that I will talk a lot about the effect of global warming and climate change. And what you will see is kind of its output, what it causes. My talk will be starting with the problems, why we need new tools for precise medicine or biology, and then what type of microfabricated tools we use in microbiology and cancer biology. Then we will shift our view a little bit and we will talk about biosensors and to give a few points regards to laparoscopic operations and surgical tools, which is mostly related to mechatronics part of my studies. And I would like to start my talk with my famous scientist quote, which is like, measure what is measurable and make measurable what is not so. And this is what my group and me, we are trying to do. First, I would like to mention what are the causes of leading reasons, what is the causes for global debt. And as you can see, numbers are up to 2019, and you see the number one cause is heart diseases, stroke, and then you have pulmonary diseases. This can also consider respiratory infections or different types of cancers here, and diabetes and so on. And you see the infectious diseases are playing a significant role as a cause of global debt. And when we move from 2019 to 2020 and 21, unfortunately, I couldn't find data for 2021 because things are changing drastically. So it is very difficult to follow and get the numbers from reliable sources. But you see, it is again an infectious disease. This is a virus pandemic and COVID-19, we have this. And these are all related to global warming. Due to global warming, now the ecosystem is changing, and then we are getting to know new type of viruses or very, very old viruses that we have forgotten as an immune system or as an ecosystem. So now we have to fight with this. In order to fight with this, we need new tools, although maybe they are very old diseases. Now, since we are not the same, so we need to change the tools to be able to cope with it. And what is the problem with the conventional tools in biology? In biology, it doesn't mean that it is particularly microbiology, bacteriology, or cancer biology. Most of the time, we do the measurements based on population values. So we grow the cells in the flask or in the culture, and then we get the average value of the populations. And then we measure growth, gene expression, protein expression, and we would like to understand the effects of drugs or antibiotics. So we see how they respond to different stresses, and we want to get rare cells, what we want to analyze, like resistor cells, antibiotic resistance, stem cells, stem type of cells, or tumor-associated immune cells. But they are very rare, and it is very difficult to find these single cells inside this population. So we need new tools. In order to explain it a little bit more detail, so this is the culture where we grow bacterium. So you put single bacterium or colony, and then it grows, make the population. And in order to measure like gene expression, let's assume, from this population, you take an aliquot of sample, you put it on the microscope. And this is what you see or you expect to see. All the cells are look alike. And they have low population heterogeneity in this population. And when you make measurements, you have a population distribution which can be described by a Gaussian distribution. So everything is normal, which means that when I pick a cell from here, it will be the same to this one, or this one. But in reality, when we get measurements from the population with the same p-value, same measurement, can represent any of these populations, which means that it can be a broadly distributed population, and the average value you measure will not describe the cells at this at the ends of this curve. Or this is an extreme situation. The average value you measure is again the same, but you don't represent any cells in the population. It is a bimodal distribution, and the p-value gives nothing related to the cell. And it can be the case, which is mostly what we observe in biology. While the majority of the cells can be described by this mean value, the cells that you are interested in will not contribute. So you won't catch these cells. It can be, again, resistant, or it can be antibiotic tolerant cells or stem cells. In your assay, you cannot see these cells. The gold standard for especially antibiotics is a colony forming assay. So we grow culture and then add antibiotic to this, make dilutions and try to count how many cells we have here with the idea that single cell, single bacterium will create one colony. So when we count the colonies, we can understand that if the drug works, the colonies numbers will decrease. So this graph shows you that the number of colonies that we observe during this experiment, and this is the time course. So initially we start and we get more cells. When we add the antibiotic, the number of colonies we observe on the plate decreased. And for this population, it decreased. For this one, it's kind of stable, and then it increased and so on. So we see different behavior of the cells. Unfortunately, one of the biggest limitations for this assay, when the cells cannot form colonies but still grow, we cannot enumerate them. So we are not aware of these cells. And we thought that the antibiotic we developed works. But in reality, since this assay cannot capture these cells, what we call viable and non-culturable, so you see that these antibiotics work. And when you give it to the patient, it will not work. And in order to eliminate all these problems, I think one of the promising tools that we have now, microscopy with microfluidic devices. You can also say that there are animals, so we can do animal experiments to understand really how it works. But first of all, when you start an animal experiment, it is difficult to set the conditions or change the environmental factors or other parameters. And eventually it is an animal, so a living organism. And they are expensive. When you want to do this experiment, you need to get special training. So when you do microfluidic devices, which can recapitulate the immune system organs or the microenvironment you would like to grow these microorganisms or cells, I think it will be more promising and more helpful than animal experiments. So here in this diagram, you see a microfluidic device, and this device mounted on a microscope, which is inside the incubator, so you can control the environment with in terms of temperature and humidity, or you can give some gases like carbon dioxide, depends on the cells that you use. And then this microfluidic device can be engineered in a way that you would like to mimic the things, or you would like to see the response. And by the help of microscopy, you can real-time visualize them. And depends on the application and the microfluidic device structure you made, you can get this data at single cell resolution from large numbers of cells. And most of the tools that I mentioned today will be microfabricated tools, which fits on the microscope. And the aim from this developing these tools or technologies, we would like to get quantitative data, which means that as an electrical engineer, when I apply voltage to something, and then if I measure it using a multimeter, I get the number and I know it. But for biological systems, most of the things, especially for imaging, it's very open to interpretation, and you can get lots of artifacts. If I do the analysis, I can get different results. If someone else does, they can get. And also, especially for cells, you will see that segmentation is a little bit problem, and it is not easy to segment and get the numbers of the cells. So this is why we would like to make biology more like physics, mathematics, or other engineering, so that we can get quantitative data without getting any interpretation or biases on it. And these tools should quantify for this, give quantitative data, real-time data, and lots of information at single cell resolution and from the large amount of cells, so that we can get statistical values. And we would like to get also rare cells that I showed you, which cannot be seen by the population assays. And if possible, control the microenvironment and then track the cells by time and by spatial distribution. Here I put one example. Actually, it was from Mehmet Yanık. At that time he was in MIT, but now I think he is ETH. He developed a device where he can put single C. elegans, it's a kind of worm, and these worms are capable of showing their organs. So he did neurosurgery on this worm. And we would like to do this type of things, which will allow us automation and getting quantitative data. So this is what we expect and what we try to do for modern tools in biology and medicine. So today I will mostly talk about the devices that we use and develop in my group. First, I want to talk about microbiology. Since initially I showed a figure related to leading causes all over the world due to infectious diseases, and one of the most powerful tools to fight with infectious diseases are antibiotics. Particularly, I will talk about bacterial infections. And we use a microfluidic device. Basically, this device has a membrane which can sandwich cells, bacteria, in between cover slip and this membrane. And on top of that, we have a PDMS channels. So you can feed this cells, and according to the setup of your experiment, you can give different drugs. And you can do experiments as long as you can, which means that the conditions can be changed during the experiment. And using this tool, we can do a single cell analysis with the obtained data. And through my talk, I will talk about Mycobacterium and E. coli. for Mycobacterium, since tuberculosis is again leading one of the leading cause, especially for developing countries or underdeveloped countries, particularly when people have these COVID infections, it also triggers all the infections related to respiratory systems. So my talk today will consider Mycobacterium smegmatis, which is a model organism for Mycobacterium tuberculosis. We use this because it is non-pathogen. In the laboratory, it allows us to work with P1 biosafety level equipments. And as you see, it's a rope-shaped bacterium. It divides every 3 hours, which also helps because tuberculosis divides every 24 hours. So if you would like to do the experiment, it fails. So you can imagine the time required to do this experiment. And the other organism, E. coli, as you know, E. coli is a model organism for many microbiology applications. For my talk, we will talk about DH5-alpha. This is a strain of E. coli. It is again a rod-shaped cell, and it divides every 30 minutes, depends on the, of course, conditions like temperature. And it is motile, whereas Mycobacterium smegmatis is not motile. Both of them can create colonies. And here we would like to see how different cells behave differently when we expose them to the same antibiotic. Here, in terms of antibiotics, I will talk about a very old drug, which is rifampicin. During my PhD studies, I was mostly talking about isoniazid. It is first-line anti-tuberculosis drugs, which is widely used. But rifampicin is relatively an old drug, but still we use it for the treatment of tuberculosis and other infections. Why I choose rifampicin? In addition to this, it also allows to be used in the pregnant woman. So for other infections and for their treatment. What we expect from any drug, any antibiotic to do? When the cells grow, when we add antibiotic to these cells, we want that all the cells will be killed by the antibiotic so that after a certain time, you shouldn't have any colonies. But as I showed you in the previous slides also, we have different profile of killing for the antibiotics. Sometimes you have rapid killing and then antibiotics stop to kill. Sometimes you have a bounce back here, so it kills, it's slow to kill, and then you have slowly increased division of cells. And sometimes you have initially rapid killing and then rapid growth. And rifampicin is this type of antibiotic. It kills the cells initially very fast, and then around like 40, 48 hours it can be. The cells, they eat this drug, inhibits, so they start to grow. This is the rifampicin, and you can see the chemical structure here. Basically, in the cell, it targets RNA polymerase so that cell cannot produce the protein necessary to survive, and it kills the cell in this way. Again, the drug itself, rifampicin, has been produced by rifampicinia, this bacterium, and this bacterium is also found in the soil. You see, when this mutation occurred in the cell, rifampicin cannot work after 48 hours. And then cells, they start to grow back. Our aim here to do research on rifampicin, whether it is possible to stop this regrowth because initial killing is really rapid. So somehow if we can stop here, then the treatment of tuberculosis or other infections which takes 6 months, 10 months to treat will become like a normal cold. So they can be treated in a few days. This is what basically we try to investigate. And as I told you, we use rifampicin for tuberculosis treatment, leprosy, and meningitis. And here I would like to show you a video. This is Mycobacterium smegmatis, a model organism for tuberculosis. You see in this video two different types of cells. Basically, the green one is wild type, what we see in normal environment. And the red one, this is what I made by genetic modification. So we call it strain. And they behave differently in the drug. In this video, you will see, first day we will grow cells. We don't add any drug. We call the food for the cell 7H9. This is medium. Then 7 days, we expose antibiotic to the cells and you will see killing. And then 2 days or after a while, we wash the drug. and you see how the effect of drug can be diminished in the presence of antibiotics, and the cells can regrow. Here we start the experiment. Cells are growing in normal medium, and then we add drug. When we add the drug, you can see cells are lysing, which means that they burst, and they some of them, they are like having different phenotypes. Again, they lyse. Some of them are becoming really, really small, but some of them, they don't. And you can see here accumulation of some proteins, so they are really under stress. But you see there is a loss of heterogeneity. None of the cells are similar. And when you wash the drug, again, you see there are the cells which look like dead, they grow back. And here you see shiny cells. We put here some dyes to understand whether the cells are dead or they are alive. So we call it propidium iodide. And you see, even if we stop antibiotic exposure, the remaining cells here, start to grow again. And for rifampicin, this occurs in a really fast manner. Here, if you don't take antibiotics properly as doctor administrated, what happens in the lungs basically? You have cells, they can be either resistors or persisters, and they tolerate the drug. After a while, when you stop taking the drug, they will start to regrow. And this time, maybe they gain some mutations, so they are resistant, which means that when you take the same antibiotic again, it will not kill the cells. So you need to get multiple antibiotics at the same time, or you need to have different antibiotics. In our lab now, Sumaira, she is a new PhD student. She did her master studies with me. She works on rifampicin, and she tried to understand the effect of the mechanism of action for rifampicin and how we can stop this regrowth in the presence of rifampicin. So in this experiment, you see we have E. coli cells instead of mycobacterium now. And this is the strain which can constitutively express green fluorescent protein. But even if this population is in normal growth, we didn't add any drug, you can see how heterogeneous it is. So that these cells will behave all differently. And we start to do this experiment with trying different doses of antibiotics, which is not administered to patients, to understand how temperature change affects, how carbon dioxide or pH change affects. And here I would like to show two quick videos that we obtained here. So this is how E. coli grows without any antibiotics. And then when we hit rifampicin, you can see the cells are becoming very small and tiny. While we are doing this experiment, we had some technical problems with the microscope, but now we fix it, so that I hope I will show you good quality of images in the next talks. From here, I would like to move to another tool which will help us to understand again these rare cells, single cells. So if I would like to, let's assume that this yellow cell is an antibiotic resistant cell, and I would like to understand what causes this resistance. So I would like to get this cell. And imagine that you need to get this cell from this colony, but this colony considers like millions of cells. Or from this culture, you want to get single cell, or from this tube. So with these normal methods, it is impossible to isolate this single cell and enrich the same type of cell to do proteomics, transcriptomics, or sequencing to understand where is the mutation or where is the protein change or transcriptional change. So for separation of the cells, we are using fluorescent activated cell sorting, magnetic activated cell sorting, and microfluidics. For PEX, we are using it a lot, and it is widely used also in clinics, not only in laboratories. Here, the biggest problem that we cannot use PEX, it requires labeling. When you label the cells, unfortunately, you cannot, have to say, obtain the same cell, because you do some modification. You might stress the cell, and we don't want. Most of the phenotypes that we would like to observe is not stable. So if you do something, they change the phenotype. So you need to get the cell as it is in the population. Then people use magnetically activated cell sorting. But for this cell sorting, You need to again use magnetic beads for this, and this is huge magnets you have for this one. So still it kind of requires labeling with antibodies or with the magnet beads. In order to eliminate these things, we choose electric field, what we call the electrophoresis, to separate the cells. And I started these studies when I was doing PhD, and I studied with Professor Reno. Here we use an array of electrodes. So we fabricated a microfluidic device, which has the electrodes here. In this time it is titanium and gold. And then we put here SG8 microchannels, so that you have channel and you have a place for your cell to flow. And when we turn the electric field here, you can see this dark or black lines, which shows the strength of electric field. So we have high field strength here and low field strength here, where you don't see any lines basically. And the electrophoretic forces can be described by this equation, which says that when you generate a field, electric field, the cells can, or the particles can be affected or feel it as a reaction force, by their geometry or medium that you use in the culture that you grow or introduced here, and electric field, how much water you apply, what is the frequency you apply. But all these things are valid for the whole cells in the population. If I would like to isolate only single cell, which is resistor or persistor, then I cannot use any of these parameters to choose the right cell. So there is a factor here we call closure asymmetry factor, and which gives the values related to permittivity and conductivity of the cell. If this value is bigger than zero, we can trap the cells on the electrode array, which means that your cell is intact, so it has high conductivity in the cytoplasm, and the electric field or electrodes feel it like conductive, so it would like to attract them. And when the cells are dead, the membrane is not intact anymore, and the medium can go through the cytoplasm. And due to diffusion, again, the cytoplasm can diffuse around, so that you have almost the same permittivity and conductivity with the medium. The electric field forces cannot do anything to these cells. This cell will not feel it. Or it can be repelled even, and we call this negative DEP. So by trapping cells and repelling cells, we would like to trap the cells that we want, like resistors and persistors, and we want to discard the cells that we are not interested in. It can be damaged, it can be healthy cells. And for this, we produce different devices and platforms for this. Here, you see the glass chip, and the design of the chip is here. And we have the electrode array you see in the center. And we introduce cells through this PDMS and PMMA block, and we apply electric field using this PCB. Then the amount of cells that we enriched using this platform was not really good. So this is we try to make high throughput from the cells. Instead of having two planar electrodes by side channels, we would like to get like pillars so that we can have high volume, and the pillars will create more electric field around this. By high or tall pillars, you can put also more volume of cells and you can get high throughput. This was collaboration with my friend who is a professor in Clemson University now. And we use 3D carbon electrodes instead of planar electrodes. Here, I would like to show how these positive and negative electrophoretic forces are creating or affecting cells. So this is the array of carbon. We give plus, minus as a signal and create electric field around this. When the cells, they are repelled by these electrodes, you will see that we look from the top. Around the circle, cell will be repelled. And then if it is positive DEP, which means that cells are more conductive, they will come close to the region of the electrodes where you have strong electric field. Here, the cells, they are like dust, they are bacteria, and they are expressing green fluorescent protein. We apply electric field. When the electric field is negative DEP, you see these electrodes are repelling the cells. And when it is positive DP, you see where we have high electric field strength, cells are trapped here. So we would like to trap resistor or persistor cells from this bulk assay or bulk population. And then we want to wash the cells which are repelled by electrodes by fluid flow. And using this, basically we did studies related to antibiotic persistent, we isolated persister cells, like 10 to 5, 10 to 6, so that we can perform proteomics and transcriptomics. The biggest problem with these technologies, you can see them on the microscope, and you cannot get these things outside the cells, outside the platform even. Or if you get them, they are a few, like hundreds or thousands, and this number is not enough to do other assays in biology. You cannot do proteomics or transcriptomics or other assays if it is less than a million of cells. In my group here, Yağmur started to do this project, and now she is doing her PhD, but her interest was most related to immune cells. So she used monocyte and macrophages, which is basically the same site, the same cell, monocyte, but we differentiate it with some chemicals and they become macrophage, active cells to grab the microbes or to fight with infections or cancer cells. Here, her aim was to isolate or understand how heterogeneous is monocyte population, macrophage population, so that macrophage or monocyte immune cells are responding to differently from patient to patient, even inside the patient, inside the organ. In some part of tumor environment, they are helping tumor cells to grow. In some part, they are killing the cancer cells and inhibiting growth. So she would like to understand electric features or the electric features of these cells. Our main aim was to try to isolate M1 and M2 type of macrophage. They call it tumor-associated macrophage. In theory, immune cells are going to tumor microenvironment to kill the cancer cells. But what happens in reality, some of them are not doing this. And instead of stopping growth of cancer cells, they are going and supporting their growth. This is why they call it tumor-associated macrophages. And if we can isolate them or understand which one is M1, which one is M2, then we can also say that, okay, this cancer can be aggressive one, or this can be going to metastasize, so that they are a really good candidates for biomarker to understand cancer great. And if we can also find M2 macrophages, then we can also use drugs to target them, or we can use them for drug delivery by engineering. This is why she would like to find a way to isolate M1 and M2 macrophage and see whether there is any differences in terms of the electric properties. I would like to show one of her videos. And here again, when you look at this carbon electrodes from top, these are electrodes. These are the electrical conductivity, basically. They connect the electrodes. These like bubble type of things that you see, they are cells. In this case, it is monocyte. And when we, this is the voltage value we apply, this is the frequency. In this experiment, we have higher frequency and then we decrease the frequency. You will see how they behave. So initially they are in this strong electric field. They create pearl chain. You can consider them like magnets. If they are strongly feeling the force, they come together. And then when we repel them, you see they are coming in the region where you don't feel an electric field. So that you can see heterogeneity difference between the cells, how the cells are responding to the electric field. Again, in this experiment, she characterized monocyte and macrophage, which are U937 cells. And she showed that there is a difference in terms of the electric response of the cells. And if you would like to isolate macrophages from monocytes, this is the frequency, like 30 kilohertz, 10 volt peak to peak is enough to separate monocyte cells from macrophages. And this is important because a number of immune cells are giving really good clues about the state of the illnesses or whether the patient is sick or not. This is why we were doing this investigation, and then we want to proceed it with the separation of tumor-associated macrophages. Meanwhile, we were curious about the dyes, because in biology we are using many dyes to stain cells, whether they are alive, whether they are dead. or we use some dyes on the membrane to count the cells, or some dyes for the nucleus. But most of these dyes, when they are produced, they are mostly checking biochemically, biochemical compatibility, physical properties in terms of diffusion, like whether they give some artifacts, which wavelength it should be used. But they don't check the electric properties, and we would like to see whether we use red dye and green dye. These are two different types of dyes we use in biology, especially in cell biology. And when we don't have any dye with the cell, this is the crossover frequency we observe. And when we have the cell, which is just going through the cytoplasm, and one gives green and the other one gives red color, they are also affecting differently. So if you would like to do some capacitive measurements, impedance measurements, and if you use these dyes, you might have some biases or artifacts. This is what we showed basically. And then when Esra joined my group, she is a master's student, she would like to more do mechanistic studies, like mechanophenotyping, how the cells behave differently when we apply different forces in, or when they are in different microenvironments, how they respond. And here she would like to combine the electrophoretic forces with mechanical effects. So we apply electric field again, which we know that this is a gentle field in comparison to flow, shear forces, because all these forces are changing cells. But when you apply electric field, it has been shown that it doesn't remain, or like it doesn't affect the cells too much. Or when you have these forces, the relapse time, which will become which is very short compared to other ones. So plasticity was the interest in these studies, and she used the same type of experiment, and then she chose single cells and followed that how they deform when we change the frequency, how they respond. So once the cells are shrinking, are they going to be always shrinking through the forces, or it can be also reversible, depends on the force. They can also shrink and then elongate. So she was looking at this, and these are the positions or forces. She tried to correlate how much force electric field applied to the cells and how much cells deformed according to reaction to these forces. For deformation, basically she measured height and width of the cells and compared the monocyte and macrophages, how much they deform, because we know that immune cells, they are highly plastic, so that they can even penetrate in nanometer range places. They can sometimes penetrate blood-brain barrier, not only the veins or vesicles. So this is why we would like to see monocyte and macrophage deformation differences. And she showed that yes, we have significant differences between macrophage and monocytes, and it also depends on frequency that we are applying to the cells. And currently, Puya joined our group. He is a new master student, and we are collaborating with Dr. Mansur Islam. He is a postdoc in Germany, and we are producing other type of devices, because our aim is here to create low cost, more effective, which will give high throughput for the cell separation. And these are new chips that we are trying in this system. From now, I would like to quickly go through the cancer biology. For cancer biology, we are working on glioblastoma multiform. Glioblastoma is one of the leading causes for brain cancer death. And as you can see here, this is from Roche, we have really less survival compared to other cancer types, unfortunately. And the treatment is not really a treatment, because we can make the patient survive maximum 2 years. Most of the drugs that we are giving to make them live better, basically. Here we would like to understand how cancer cells and immune cells talk. And for this, I get to know this field by Professor Rong Fan, where I did my postdoc studies. Here we were trying to understand when two cells talk, they are using proteins, and how the protein profile changes, whether it depends on the position of the cells, when they are closer, are they talking more, or when they are far away, they are secreting more things, which proteins they are using to talk. And for this, we were using this device, and now he made a company, IsoPlexis, from this, and he can do from patient sample proteomics. So he can say, for this patient, for this cancer type, we have this protein profile, so we need to use these drugs for chemotherapy. And these are some results that we found according to number of cells and their position, which proteins were expressed. In our lab, basically, instead of proteomics, we try to focus on more cell culturing platforms. And my previous master's student, Sal and Hande, developed tools. Our aim here was to give drugs, which is using a gradient generator, so that automatically will be dosed when we don't need to arrange the dose of the drug. So dosing will be done by this gradient. And then we combine this gradient to the cell culture chambers so that the cells, which they grow in the same microenvironment, when they expose to different concentration of these drugs, how they will respond. In order to see that, first we grow the cells in the microfluidic channels and then test the gradient generator by food dye so that we can see there is a gradient of the colors. And we confirm that this drug works. And then we apply it using some detergents, and it was ready for the drug experiments. But now we move mostly to understand mechanical properties of the cell than long-term culturing. And we try to understand in these microfluidic platforms how do cells move. For example, this is the cell when they expose to immune cells. They are moving in a different way than when they are in their normal medium where there is no immune cells. And we compare or quantify their pets, their velocities. And we see how they are changing wound healing, how they are aggressive when we have cells with immune cells and when we have cancer cells alone. Whether this migration and deformation is significant, how they are contributing cancer cells to become more invasive, basically, this is what we are looking. And she quantifies the formation of the cells. For example, when glioma, brain cancer cells, when there is no any immune cells, this is distribution of their deformation. But when we give them to immune cell media, you see they are becoming more stressed and more uniform they are. They are deforming and becoming like Poisson shape. And then we confirm these studies with some measuring protein levels, like Vimentin, which shows how aggressive the cells become, or Icodirin, how they are creating more communication with the other cells, how they adhere to the surface. From now, Ünal joined our group. He's a master's student, and he tried to use deep learning techniques to segment these cells, because as you see, it is difficult to get the number of these cells to quantify. Counting manually is tough. So he used some deep learning algorithms to segment these cells. This is a new project. I would like, since I know the time is almost done, I just want to say that we are also working on biosensors. And for these biosensors, one prototype we produced to detect genomic DNA from genetically modified soybean. And for this project, Sumaira and Dokan worked. We try to understand whether the soybean or food has genetically modified organism genes inside, or this is like natural one. And in our platform, when there is a genetically modified region in this genome, we have color differences between the control ones where there is no GDO, we call GDO. And for this, we use a LAMP, loop-mediated isothermal amplification procedure, and we did our control experiment for the device in terms of temperature and heat distribution. Our device was capable of detecting genetically modified soybean and maize. These are some proofs regarding to this. Now, Sumaira and Ünal are working on, instead of DNA, RNA detection. And this is a collaboration with TechFam project. We try to detect potato virus Y, which causes necrotic regions like rings on the potato, so that it affects the income of the potato and marketing. So we try to detect this PY1 virus. This is a normal RNA, basically, based off virus, how it goes to host, how it penetrates. And last point I want to say, especially since I'm in mechatronics engineering, most of the students are coming me to develop some tools or do some mechanical studies. So since my master research was related to this, I say, okay, let's do some laparoscopic tools for laparoscopic operation to make them more automated. And instead of using always this robotics, which is super expensive, and most of the places people don't have these tools like machines, robots, or trained personnel, how we can make laparoscopic tools more automated, more smart, so that people can do these operations without needing this. And Puya, who joined recently as a master's student, he will work on this project. We did some tools, we developed some tools and get patent from this, thanks to our surgeon, Turul Tansu. He helps us. Sometimes we go to operation rooms with him so we can see which tool works, how, what are the problems with these tools. And now Puya will try to make smart phantom so that people can do this training of thyroid surgery using a platform which gives like similar properties, and then we can measure the, we can equip it with the sensors, and we can measure what is wrong, what is good, so that by the Internet of Things, surgeons can follow the trainees and they can teach them better from remote places. Finally, I would like to thank all my group members, current ones, previous ones, collaborators, and the support, particularly from Sabancı University, Faculty of Engineering and Science, and then Sunum, Marie Curie, and Turkish societies, TÜBİTAK. And lastly, to my advisors, which allow me as an engineer to be part of biology and medicine. So I would like to thank you. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to take. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. I was waiting for Sanmiye Hocam to
okay.
jump in. thank you. Thank you for a great presentation. So I just want to remind the our audience that they can type in their questions in the Q&A, and there are already two questions.
I saw.
So if you can read them out loud and then answer, that would be great. I'm not sure if it's visible to all our audience.
Okay. fantastic seminar. First of all, thank you for your great presentation. I have a question. If we have solid drug or solid sample, such nanotubes, for example, how could you attach it to the electrodes or on plant to have some analysis like conductivity or etc.? Did you have such this experience during your work? Basically, for particles, yes, the electrophoresis, people do a lot with nanoparticles, and but it depends on what type of material you will use. And of course, geometry is also important, because when you have more edges, you will feel more strength. It depends on totally type of your material and what you would like to measure from this. If you need any help, I would be very happy to help on that. It is possible. I haven't done, I directly started to do with cells, but I have colleagues, they were doing particles, particle interaction or separation of particles. Mostly we do these studies to calibrate our system before introducing the cells. And then what are the parameters of CM factor, how it is calculated for the target cell? Yeah, the parameters for the CM factor, it is the, if you are talking about the cell, permittivity and conductivity of the cell, and then where you put these cells as a medium. So permittivity of this medium that you put, conductivity of the medium that you put, how much frequency you apply. Because when you have higher frequencies, you are increasing the possibility of penetration. So it depends on the frequency. This is all two questions and my answers to them.
Thank you so much. I have a similar question. So the experiments you showed where you wanted to differentiate between M1 and M2 macrophages, or even with the resistant persistent cells bacteria from the rest. So what was it about the cell that determined how it would behave? Okay. And how were you sure that, you know, your persistence would get stuck on the posts?
Yes. Why they become persistent, if I correctly understand, this was the perturbation.
No. Why the persistent cells were stuck to the posts, but not the others?
Because they have intact cell membrane or cell wall compared to the ones which are affected by drugs. Most of the drugs that we are using as antibiotics, they are targeting cell wall components. So the electrical forces, the electrophoretic forces can be selective based on the conductivity, like impedance of the membrane.
Uh-huh.
But to make them confirm, you need to do again like transcriptomics or proteomics to check which genes are differently expressed or which proteins are differently expressed.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why we would like to enrich them like 10 to 6, 10 to 7 cells per ml, and then do the other analysis to confirm, this is persistent, this is not resistant. Mm-hmm. But for the drugs, we know at 48 hours, the cells that we have, they are persistent or they are dead. If you continue to give drug, they become resistant. So persistence is the phase between normal drug sensitive to drug resistant phase.
Okay.
This is how. Would it be possible to separate cells from more crowded environment like blood? Yes, people are also doing this. But as you know, blood is more conductive compared to the media that we use. So you need to adjust or you need to modify your setup according to that. Sometimes people are using filtration first to eliminate the other types of cells than what you are interested in. And then they apply the electrophoretic forces. They can use filters. They can use inertial microfluidics for this. But yes, it is possible, and I think Dr. Toner was one of the first who tried to separate from blood the circulating stem cells.
Meltem Hocam, no more questions at the moment. We would like to thank you for your very impressive talk. We are happy to host here. So I think we need to close at that moment. So thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Have a nice evening for Turkey and have a nice evening for US. Huh? Başak Hocam, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Yeah. We'll see you in 2 weeks.
Yes. Bye. See you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.